You remember this cheap DC power supply that I was playing with a few weeks ago, gotten in a mailbag and decided to test it out? Well, in the process of testing that, it occurred to me that I should probably have a better test load. I was just using some high power resistors at the time, and I've ordered some more to give me some more flexibility, but I think an electronic load would probably work better. Now I do have this one, and it is up to the task. It can provide a fairly stable, fairly high level load, but that's not what it's designed for. This unit is actually designed to do discharge tests of batteries over time, and that's how its menus are set up. Yeah, you can tell it to give me a load at this level, but then if you want to change that, you've got to shut it off, dick around in the menus, turn it back on again, and so on and so on and so on. So, I mean, it could do it, but I want something that's a little bit more flexible and easy to deal with.
Which got me searching around online, of course, and I found this little schematic here, which is nice and simple and perfect. Step one, ignore the entire left side of that. We don't need it. We'll just use some other power supply. So what we have left is one op amp, one potentiometer, a 10K resistor, a 1-ohm resistor, and a MOSFET, preferably a logic level input MOSFET, and then a couple of capacitors. And that is it. Of course, we need an external ammeter, but I've got lots of ammeters kicking around here.
So power resistors, op amps, MOSFET. Let's see what we can find in this mess. 100 ohms, no. 2.5K, what is this? This is when they salvage out of that microwave. No, that's 2K ohms. That doesn't help me. What else we got? 25K, 10K, 100 ohms. 1 ohm, 10 watts. It's a little light, but that'll do. Op amps. I don't think I want a 741 LM358. Sold. And then N-channel MOSFET, IRF, Z44N. Yeah, that'll do. And probably a heat sink for that MOSFET. I wish I had some TO3 MOSFETs around here, but I don't. Wonder what happens if I clamp a couple of these back to back and then do that. I think that'll do for an experiment. I think I'll use my meltiest old beat up breadboard just so that it's no loss, because I'm thinking this is going to get pretty hot.
The 1 ohm resistor goes to the source side of the MOSFET,
which is this pin over here. I think that gets it out of the way.
Then the gate of the MOSFET goes off towards the op amp, which I'm going to put on a different board that isn't as melty and destroyed.
The gate is pin 1, and the feed to the load can come off the drain. I'll just use these pins in here to give me something to grab onto. Yeah, that's not shorting against anything, okay. And the op amp can just live on this other board. I think I want to keep them separate just to keep the heat away. And I trust this one to not be quite as damaged as this one. And we'll use the Canaduino power supply board just to provide the low voltage, low current power to the op amp. Sure, why not?
Okay. 10K resistor from the output of the op amp down to ground and connect that off to the gate connection.
Pin 1 to ground and also the gate. And I don't know, do we want to follow through pin by pin, or can you deal with it just off the schematic and freeze frame it? Oh well, whatever, we'll just carry on here. Pin 4 to ground, pin 8 to positive voltage, potentiometer, let's throw that over here just for fun, and it is going between VCC and ground. It is literally just a voltage divider. And how this works, I suppose I could have gotten into that a little bit more, basically the op amp is going to change its output voltage based on the difference between the inverting and non-inverting inputs. So if the inverting and non-inverting inputs are exactly the same, there's going to be no output voltage. But if there's a difference between them, the output voltage is going to change. So what this is going to do is one of the inputs, the non-inverting input, is coming from here, coming from this potentiometer, pin 3. And the inverting input is coming from... So here is that voltage sense wire, and that is going into the inverting input, pin 2. This is just a ground. The current is not, the high current's not going to be running through it. I'm going to connect the device under test between these two points here. So that's just a reference voltage. There's no current. There's not going to be any voltage drop through that. But this, I think, is essentially the entire circuit. I could add those two capacitors. They're just for stability. I'm not going to bother with it right now. There is some capacitors in the power supply over here, so I'm not too stressed about it. Let's see if it works. For my first test, I'm just going to use this power supply because it's got a built-in ammeter, so I can tell if I'm reading properly. And that load is going to go across here. That voltage, rather, is going to go across there and there. And power this guy. This is set to 5 volts right now, which I think should be okay, I hope. So we got power there. This is set for 5 amps, and it's just current limiting at 1 volt. So that's not going to overload that guy. I'll turn that down. Let's see what happens. Power on. No current being drawn there. And if we turn that up, there we go, we get some current draw. Cool. And so this is in current limit right now, and it's dragged the voltage down. So that's pretty close to 1 amp. Let's crank the current limit up on this guy. I don't know how far we can go. Let's go to 3 amp current limit. And we'll adjust a little bit more here, and we'll see how much we can get. Okay, that's topping out at about 1.3 amps. Why is that?
So I did a bit of searching around, and here's the MOSFET that he specified in his circuit, an IRL540. For a fully on, it has a voltage between the gate and the source of 5 volts. But that's not the MOSFET I'm using. I'm using an IRFZ44N, and its low resistance drain source voltage is 10 volts. So that's why I can't turn it on far enough to get the full current that I want. So the easy fix would be to... feed my circuit, not the device under test, but the testing circuit with a higher voltage. Can the op amp handle that? Oh yeah, of course it can. 3 to 36 volts, no problem. Okay, well that's an easy fix then.
All I need to do is switch this guy up to its 12 volt setting, which is the cool thing about this little breadboard power supply that a lot of others can't do. It's got extra voltages on it. So that should mean that my full range here is now from 0 to 10 or 0 to 12 volts, and 12 volts is high enough to drive this thing fully into saturation if I have to. Now let's see what happens. 1, 2, 3, and I'm current limiting here again. Nice. While that's happening, let's just take a look, see what's going on over here with the thermal camera. The resistor looks like it's the hot spot at about 82 degrees. The MOSFET is still chilling out at about 30 or thereabouts. That's not 38. Okay, we can live with that for now. Of course, that's only 3 amps. Let's pop this current limit as high as it'll go, which is about 6 amps. Okay, actually, let's turn up the voltage too, just for more watts. Let's try 12 volts and a bit. So we should max out now at 12 volts and 6 amps if this works properly. Yeah, there we go. We're current limiting. Now that resistor's getting some warm. And what's going on there? 78, 83, 90. It's getting pretty warm. Easy fix for that. We'll just turn them down. But that does prove that it works and does what it's supposed to do, even if it's getting a little bit hot. I'm going to have to, I think, come up with a little bit better, better heat sinking for that. Okay. I'm going to go away and basically solder this down onto a circuit board, just a piece of perf board, so it's a little bit more permanent. And I'm going to see if I can find, let's see if I can find a bit better heat sink for that too. That will be useful. I think I have some over here in my harvested parts bin. I might want some of these fans too. No? Oh, maybe, but it's already got guys on it. Oh, well, that ought to do it. I wonder if I could even clamp the resistor onto there somehow. That might be a good idea. Anyway, as I said, I'm going to just commit this to a perf board to make it a little bit more semi-permanent. Nothing's ever permanent around here, but you know what I mean. A little bit less janky than that, and I shall return. Okay, quite a bit of time has passed, and here we have the fruits of my labors. I never promised that it was going to be a thing of beauty, but at least it's all one piece. It's all soldered solidly together. Don't look too carefully at the bottom, but I hope it works. It's together. Anyway, let us try. I'm going to power it from this 12-volt wall wart. I've got my bench power supply set to 12 volts and 6 amps. I'll turn that on. This is powered on. Let's see what happens when we turn the knob up. Oh, hey, would you look at that? It's doing the thing. Cool. And this thing at 6 amp current limit. There we go. Let's just get the thermal camera in here and see what's what. See if that bigger heat sink's doing anything. It looks like it is pulling a little bit of heat away from the resistor. Oh, the resistor is still 300 degrees. The MOSFET is about 125. Oh, there's smoke coming off stuff. Okay, let's shut that off. What is smoking? Well, that's just the resistor. Okay, that is only a 10-watt resistor. So I think this is a little bit too much power for it. Our handy-dandy Ohm's Law cheat sheet. We have volts and current, so 12 volts times 6 amps is 72 watts, which is just a little bit too much for a 10-watt power resistor, even with a big heatsink on it. But that means that this all works, and that's the important part of the exercise. So now, to get back to seeing what this thing will do, or if it will exceed this too. Also, let me let this cool down for a bit, and I will be back. All right, here is our testing setup. I have this meter connected to the outputs of the power supply under test. It is just set on DC volts. I have this meter in series with the positive side of the connection between the power supply and the load. The negative connection from the load just goes back to the power supply. As a refresher, this power supply claims to be 12 volts at up to 16.67 amps. The consensus from the last video this thing appeared in is not a chance in hell. When I tested it in that previous video, I only had resistors that would pull this thing to 3 amps, and it was able to do that. So let us just see what happens here. Power on. We have 12 volts. Can you see that? Sort of. There. So now then, if we start bringing the current up, we have current up here. 1 amp. 2 amps, still holding 12 volts. 3 amps, still holding. We knew that because we tested it like that before. 4 amps, 4.2 amps. We've dropped a little bit here, 12.06. So we've dropped like 4 100s, not much. Starting to drop a little bit more here, 4.7, 4.8, 4.9. Okay, now, ooh, we're down below 12 volts now. So they're 5 amps and 12.02. We're still okay. Another 100 milliamps, and we start dropping seriously here down to 9 volts at 5.2 amps. If we go any higher, 5.2 amps, it seems to be just current limiting at 7.9 volts. So the naysayers were correct. This thing doesn't do even half, not even a third of what it claims to be able to do. I guess if I need it for 5 amps or less, well, probably realistically 4 amps or less. I don't think I'd want to push it any harder than that. Yeah, if I got 4 amps worth of LEDs to power or something else non-critical, I guess that will do the job. However, our homemade test load here works like a champ. I am quite pleased with that. I am going to have to do something to make it a little bit more permanent, maybe? I don't know, maybe it can just live like that in its glorious jankiness. I mean, it's solid. The only thing that's really letting me down, I think, is that resistor. So I'm going to have to jump on eBay, AliExpress, Banggood, wherever, and see if I can find some higher wattage 1-ohm resistors to supplement this or to, well, to replace it probably, bolt it onto the heatsink somewhere else, and life will be good. Well, thanks everybody for stopping by and checking this out. I do appreciate it. Questions and comments, and I'm sure there will be some down below as usual. Yeah, thanks for watching. I'll talk to you later.